Harvest Show, where faith makes a world of difference.
Hello and welcome to this Friday edition of The Harvest Show. Journalist and author Jon Gauger returns to today's program to share some fascinating insights from influential Christian leaders in his project, If I Could Do It All Over Again. We're also going to have Brian Bush for you today. He's in Jerusalem with the latest on White House peace talks with Palestinian leader Mahmoud Abbas. And interesting perspective that we'll get from Brian there as well. I know that yesterday, Valerie, National Day of Prayer, mm-hmm. and President Trump signed an executive order. But he also made a statement that there can be no peace in Israel until the Palestinian Authority acknowledges and condemns terrorism, which, it's kind of a common sense thing to say, but maybe not mm-hmm. a politically correct thing to say in the light of the delicate and fragile nature of the peace talks that have been going on for, good three, 4 decades now.
That's right, and Brian will report on the meeting between the two leaders, what's happening and, to be a fly on the wall in that meeting. Of course, I'm sure a lot of journalists would love to have that perspective. Yes, he did say that, and it is not politically correct to say that. We, previous presidents have kind of stayed in the middle with that,
yes.
or kind of skirted
around the edges. Yeah.
So
yeah.
It'll be interesting to hear what Brian has to say to get that perspective. I want to know as well.
Yeah. And the executive order that was signed yesterday on the National Day of Prayer, a lot of symbolism there as well, where basically yes. President Trump and the White House saying that they're kind of rolling back the Johnson Amendment. I didn't read the executive order. I've wanted to. I just had trouble kind of trying to find it online just to read the exact language of it. But from reports, both from, conservative and liberal sources, basically saying that they're relaxing the enforcement or regulations of the Johnson Amendment instituted by Lyndon B. Johnson, which kind of put a barrier between nonprofits and the political world, saying that religious nonprofits could be in jeopardy of their nonprofit standing if they were to be too politically active. And there's a lot of gray area because it doesn't spell out where the line is in the Johnson Amendment of what is permissible, what's not permissible. It just kept it very subjective by saying, too politically mm-hmm. Active.
And that's why this, the signing was so important to pastors, because of course pastors and leaders will fall under that nonprofit mm-hmm. Title. And now they don't have that concern that the IRS will take away their tax exempt status.
Right.
But at the same time, Stephen, does not give leaders the right or the freedom to publicly just get up and endorse
yes.
and
yeah.
Tell congregants this is
who you need to vote for.
Yeah.
Which I think a lot of congregation members would kind of be offended at
yes,
that too.
Yes, yes. I've already told you I don't like going to church to hear someone tell me who I should vote for.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting.
The other part of the I believe it's the name of the executive order, something to do with religious liberty or something like that, Religious Liberty Act or something. Had to do with nonprofits that are faith-based, not having to subscribe to or adhere to regulations of the Affordable Care Act when it comes to birth control, contraception, things like that. I know that Notre Dame here locally was one in a plaintiff class action suit. I think Sisters of Mercy mm-hmm. Was another group where these nuns saying, why do we have to pay for contraception?
Yeah, that's
we're
right.
nuns. Why should that be in our
that's
in
right.
our health care plan?
Yeah. And it's a violation. Of conscience. So, very interesting decisions mm-hmm. that our president is. The executive orders that he's been signing, very interesting. And that's why we should always pray for our leaders.
Amen. And we want to hear from you as well about these things and anything else that's on your heart. You can connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, and live at LeSEA.com. Still to come, our guest, journalist Jon Gauger.
We'll be right back. Got Facebook? Follow The Harvest Show.
Comment and share your opinions on current events.
See new After the Show guest interviews.
Watch my updates and inspiration from Israel exclusively for Facebook.
Facebook.com/The Harvest Show. Like us today.
We know you're working daily to make healthy choices for your life and the life of your loved ones. MHC Life is here to help you with those choices by offering supplements and materials that maximize your personal health and total well-being. This May, give the women in your life beauty from inside out. Our beauty pack will help her focus, sleep well, boost her heart health, and rejuvenate her skin. Order today for $49 and save $39 plus get free shipping. Visit MHCLife.com or call 1-800-965-2345.
Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed to thy word. LeSEA Broadcasting is dedicated to getting thousands of free Bibles into the hands of young people around the world this year. Will you help? Call 1-800-365-3732 today.
If you could do life all over again, what would you do differently? Jon Gauger is the co-host of several national programs for Moody Bible, and when he asked more than 28 well-known Christian leaders the do-over question, their answers were open and brutally honest, and he returns to the show with more of his insights on this project. Welcome back to
Thank
the Harvest Show, Jon. Wow, it was just fascinating. I'll pick up where we left off yesterday. So you talked with these Christian leaders, and they were just open with you about some good, the bad, regrets, things they would like to do more of. Where did you come up with the concept?
Well, I think that must be from God, you know. I'm a naturally curious person, and Stefan, Valerie, I think he just sort of used that curiosity, and the book all came together.
Yeah. Okay, so you asked them a number of questions. Yeah. What was probably the most difficult question they found? I mean, you know, in answering.
I think regrets. I said, what regrets do you have? Mm-hmm. And there were a number of those. You know, people regretted things like leaving a ministry too soon before it was evident that God had called them to leave. Certainly regrets they have with regard to family, not enough time with kids. Ravi Zacharias said to me, interestingly enough, here's this great apologist known around the world, speaks on universities here and there. He said, I regret never having even one conversation with my dad in which I said, Dad, what was it like for you growing up? What was it like when you were a kid? He was sort of a serious, almost harsh man, so it wasn't a natural to have that kind of conversation, but I never pushed it, we never had it, and now it's too late. He regrets that.
With respect to interviewing all of these Christian leaders and spending time with them, you know, on the phone, face to face, how long did this take to pull together?
More than a year. Mm-hmm. More than a year of conversations, all of which lasted about 20 to 30 minutes. As you say, some were in person, some were on the phone. All of them were recorded.
Share some of the stories that you gleaned from them. I mean, it must have been really interesting to sit there and watch them and listen to them be vulnerable with you.
Yeah. I laugh when I think of Gary Chapman. Here's the author of the millions and millions of copies sold, Five Love Languages from Northfield Publishing. Here's a guy, you know, who could be more competent than Gary Chapman, right? And in the chapter Life Lessons, he said, a life lesson I'll never forget. I've just graduated from college. I've got my degree. Spring me loose on the world. I'm ready for anything. And I'm at the time, he says, working at a print shop. And my job was to operate a little folding machine. Do you know, he says, I couldn't get that crazy folder to work for a couple of days. And it suddenly occurred to me, John 15:5, Jesus saying, without me, you can do nothing. I couldn't even run a dumb folder, he said. Interestingly enough, Johnny Tata, whom you know well, we asked in the chapter, what are you looking forward to most about heaven? She says, you know, most people would assume that having spent a half a century in a wheelchair, the number one thing I'm looking forward to about heaven is to jumping up and down and doing somersaults, and that'll be great, but that's not the number one thing. The number one thing I'm looking forward to in heaven is never having to have another harsh word with someone, never another selfish thought, never a need for an apology, being free from sin. So that was kind of cool.
That is pretty cool. And I was going to ask you about that chapter, the last chapter in the book, you know, the one thing that you're looking forward to most. What were some of the responses to that?
Well, a lot of people said, you know, I'm looking forward to being with Jesus, you know, obviously having a conversation with Jesus. Tony Evans said, and I like this, he said, I'm looking forward to seeing some sort of a heaven version of video replay of some of the great moments of the Bible, you know, the parting of the Red Sea. I want to see it
3D surround, you know, 360.
You know, HD, you know, or who knows.
John, it's always interesting to talk with well-known leaders, to talk with these people, to find out, you know, some of the good and the bad, the decisions that they've made. But what's the takeaway for everyday people, people who are watching us saying, you know, I want a do-over in life and that's not possible, but how can I pick up now and improve?
Yeah, well, you asked the $1,000 question right there, Valerie. We can't go back. We can't. I like one quote in the book is, you know, what might have been does not exist. So why bother even going there? One takeaway would be when we sit there and indulge these memories, it's like releasing the same brain chemicals that happened the first time when we made the mistake. So it's like we're remaking that mistake. We talk about regrets being like scars of the soul. When I was 15 years old, I had major surgery on my back. I was cut open from my my waist all the way to my neck. And after a two-week period of being flopped every 4 hours on a circular steel bed from my stomach to my back, they announced tomorrow is casting day. You're going to get a body cast. And by the way, your incision has healed just enough that you might feel an itching sensation tonight. Don't scratch. Well, that's like saying to somebody in the desert, you know, don't think about water. It did begin to itch, and so I did scratch. Well, you know what happens. It itches all the more. It's not an itching sensation. It's an itching warfare that's going on. And the nurse said, stop that. And I survived the night only by thinking through every Bible verse I'd ever memorized. But regrets are just like that. The memory comes back. We recall it. We itch it, right? Scratch it. And it scratches and itches all the more. But regrets are not where we ought to live. It's where we visit. But it's repentance where we go on. Another story, if I could. We were on board, Diane and I, on board the Africa Mercy, the world's largest charity hospital ship, 500 feet long. We're below decks looking at surgeries in process, the wonderful work that these people are doing, mercy ships. And day one, I run into a girl who's been severely burned. She has been the victim of a fire in her hut. And she's on board the Africa Mercy to get some reconstructive facial surgery. But when you pass her in the hall, it's jolting first time because the disfiguration is so severe. I think I said hello that first day. I don't remember. The second day, I certainly did. The third day, I got her name. The fourth day, it was small talk. And the fifth day, it was almost like you didn't even see the scars. We were just two neighbors on the same floating ship in a harbor in Monrovia, Liberia. Do you know God sees us that way? We've got the scars, they're there, but he doesn't see them. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. That, I think, is the ultimate good news about our regrets.
Is there a particular chapter or topic that, I mean, you've just spoken very passionately about regrets, but is there a particular chapter or topic, and if I could do it all over again, that has ministered to you the most?
Certainly that one about regrets, that we don't have to be defined by our regrets. You know, we serve a God who's all about do-overs. When our granddaughter Jocelyn was not quite as steady on her feet as she is now, she was out with us at our camper. We've got a little set of wooden steps built up there and a platform at the top. And one day we're out at the campfire and she's inside the camper. She comes out of that camper and, as little tots are wont to do, she gets one foot not quite right and she goes tumbling down these steps, just flopping into the gravel and the mud. And we jump up. Is she breathing? Is she alive? Did she break her neck? And she kind of pulls herself up and dusts herself off. And through her tears, she hops right back up on those steps and she announces, now let's try that again.
Wow.
And just like that, boom, 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 she walked down those steps without incident. I think Jesus wants to say to every single Harvest Show viewer today, you've got regrets, but let's try that again.
Yeah.
Let's try that again. It isn't over. Let's try that again.
What about this? A principle I'm desperate to pass on. What did they say?
Well, a lot of people were very interested, of course, in their kids knowing who Jesus is, that he's the supreme ruler of the universe. Tony Evans said, I'm desperate for my kids to understand that they have to serve God with the totality of life. You can't pick and choose the areas that you want to submit yourself to, you know. It's all of life. Those would be a couple of the responses that come to mind.
And what's the big deposit, the takeaway, the seed that you hope to sow into the hearts and lives of the readers when they go through If I Could Do It All Over Again?
Well, when they read If I Could Do It All Over Again, they're going to read a collection of 28 people who are well-known, whose books they read, whose songs they sing, whose sermons they hear, but have also got regrets, have also got mistakes. Mm. And I think that's refreshing. It's disarming. It says, hey, if they've blown it, and I've blown it, and God's using them, then God can use me. That's the encouragement, I think.
Wow, this is so powerful. Thank you so much for joining us. It's called If I Could Do It All Over Again. Christian leaders share the most important lessons of their lives. To connect with John, go to doitalloveragain.net or go to harvest-tv.com for his new project, Do It All Over Again. Coming up later, Pastor Charles with your prayer request. But up next, Brian Bush with the latest news from Israel. We'll be right back.
Here in Malawi, in this area, there are no deep wells. These are shallow wells dug in the bottom of a dried out riverbed where they wait for water to rise up through the rocks below. Memory here, she's got about 5 gallons, 40 pounds of water that she'll carry on her head back to her home just to have for her and her family. Here's an opportunity for you to help sponsor a well so that in places like this, they have a deep water well nearby so they could have healthy water for a healthy life.
Do you long to visit the Holy Land, but don't want to travel alone? On a LeSEA tour to Israel, you're not alone. Our team of professionals has more than 50 years' experience bringing Christians together in the fascinating land of the Bible. You and your new friends will worship together as you sail the Sea of Galilee, break bread in the Garden Tomb, and get baptized in the Jordan River, just like Jesus and the disciples did more than 2,000 years ago. What better way to experience the sights and sounds of ancient Jerusalem than with other believers from around the world? To join us for a life-changing trip to Israel, November 8th through 17th, 2017, go online to LeSEATours.com or call 1-800-685-3732. Tell the operator to send you a free information packet today. But seats are limited, so don't wait. Call now. Just one visit to the Holy Land, and your faith will never be the same.
Friends, in our time together today, let's focus in on this week's meeting at the White House between Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas and U.S. President Donald Trump. Firstly, a summary. Nothing concrete was really achieved in the meeting, although the very fact that President Abbas was invited to and attended the meeting is encouraging. What has been the Israeli reaction to this meeting? Well, Israel wasn't expecting much. However, they did want the concrete action of Mr. Abbas stopping payments to families of Palestinians who carry out an act of violence against Israel. They wanted this as a demonstration that Mr. Abbas is serious about peace. But President Abbas is already unpopular here in the Palestinian areas, and such a move would further destabilize the little legitimacy that he has. And the Palestinians, what did they make of it? For this, we have to look at the people. The people have perceived the Trump administration as one that is pro-Israel. However, a U.S. envoy has assured the Palestinian leadership that Mr. Trump wants peace to come to both peoples and that he backs an earlier plan endorsed by the Arab League back in March. Hamas has said that Mr. Abbas is selling out the Palestinian people. The media here has suggested that this whole meeting was simply meant to flatter Mr. Trump. and has suggested that nothing has changed. But President Trump said he wants a deal. And as far as he is concerned, what steps can be made towards peace? Well, the fact is, steps like this meeting are positive. Anytime there is high-level dialogue, it is a step forward. But it is a starting point that has been repeated over the decades as committees and other high-level negotiations have taken place. They've come and gone with no effect. Large gaps of land and recognition issues are in place and have yet to be resolved. And it's something that both the Palestinians and Israelis continue to struggle with, particularly their leadership, as it is the leadership which must have the will to move peace forward.
And Crowder is going to be at the July 14th concert for Pulse FM's Downtown Summer Series. There you see the info. June 9, July 14, August 11. Some great, great music and worship together with the Body of Christ all around the Michiana area. If you're in our neck of the woods, come downtown for the summer series. And you can get more information on PulseFM.com. Pastor, we just got a couple moments here. National Day of Prayer yesterday. Today is going to be a day of praise reports.
Well, it is a day of praise reports. You know, we got so many that's coming in, just like prayer requests. You know, Ann in Indiana, Ann says that my friend had to go into surgery, had a brain aneurysm, and as a result, prayer line helped bring him out of it.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow,
helped bring him out of it. Then also we have Benny in Texas. Benny said that his son had to go into the hospital. Diabetes is causing his leg to be amputated. We prayed about that, and as a result, only his large toe had to be amputated.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Praise so God. There's a lot of good things happening in, through prayer and in prayer life.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. Awesome. And more can happen as more people call in. Right. We thank you for making those calls. And when the Lord moves in your life, call back. Send an email back to prayer@lesea.com. Give our prayer line a call back and let us know what the Lord is doing. Testify about God's goodness and His power and the fact that He's answered prayer so that we can encourage others as well. 1-800-365-3732 is the number for our prayer line center. Whether it's prayer or praise, we want to hear from you today. God bless you. See you next week.
What if I told you that there's a place full of loved ones' photos that gets prayed for regularly? Prayer offers a direct line to God, so who couldn't use a little more of it? Getting yourself or your loved ones on this wall is as easy as click and send. The chapel at LeSEA Prayer Line has a wall of love that's waiting to be filled up. Just email your pictures to prayer@lesea.com. That's it. Our chapel has been a focal point for prayer for the last 18 years. Let our prayer team pray for you.
When Jesus gave His great commission to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, He was not just speaking to His disciples, He was speaking to you and me. Through the outreaches of LeSEA Broadcasting's television, shortwave radio, free Bible distribution, and prayer line, souls come to faith and are saved every day. As a financial partner with LeSEA Broadcasting, you too will be investing into the lives of men, women, and children as we proclaim God's word around the world together. LeSEA Broadcasting partners in faith make it possible for millions to hear the word of God in over 190 countries. You can be a partner in faith with us for as little as a monthly gift of $25. Your gifts help LeSEA Broadcasting bring life, hope, and love into a dark world. Call 1-800-365-3732 and tell the prayer operator you want to be a partner in faith. That's 1-800-365-3732. Be a part of the Great Commission.
The Harvest Show is produced by LeSEA Broadcasting and is viewer supported by people just like you. Thank you for inviting us into your home today.